Good afternoon, friends. This is Brother Julius once again here on the Just Word Show. Very, very excited to be able to have this opportunity to share with you. Of course, most of the time we discuss the word. Actually, we do. We discuss the word because we realize that's the final authority. But guess what, friends? We had a special guest come on 2 weeks ago. And that show, if it was not the most popular show that we've ever done, it definitely ranks in the top 5 percentile, maybe 10 percentile, of the most popular shows that we've ever done here on the Just Word Show.
Yes.
The response, the comments, mm-hmm. the kind words, the wow, we needed that. It was almost overwhelming. It was such that we knew we had to continue on in that same way, on the same topic. We had mentioned to our special guest that we had, hey, look, let's do another show. Let's expand upon this. Let's build on this momentum. People are requesting it. People love it. And she so graciously and thankfully agreed to help us. She is going to be our resident Just Word health and nutrition expert. and even fitness too, because she's a personal trainer. I mean, in fitness in terms of exercise and things. All the way around, she is a guru, mm-hmm. an expert in terms of nutrition, in terms of fitness, and all around health and physical well-being. We are so glad that she came back to join us. Let's hear a round of applause for our special guest, Dr. Brooke Bussard.
Yes.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Just Word Show.
Thanks, Julius. And
and I'll tell you something else. You are the first guest that we've ever had on the show that have come back twice within 1 month. Yes, because when folks saw the show and they heard what was happening, they wanted more.
Well, it's urgent.
Yeah, well, it is urgent.
Yeah.
It is urgent. So, look, let's recap a little bit. I want you to remind us of the hope that you gave us. You gave us hope. And I want you to take 5 or 10 minutes, whatever you feel like you need to take, because it's so vitally important that you remind us of the hope. Of there is hope for folks who are struggling with diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, arthritis, gout, even cancers.
Right.
You talked about how that much of it, if not much of it, I'll say most of it, is directly related to our eating habits.
Correct.
So what I want you to do is just take a few minutes and remind folks that there is hope, that the diagnosis does not have to mean our doom. And that there is victory.
Yes.
It's your turn to talk.
I just returned yesterday from the International Conference on Nutrition in Medicine, where 1,000 physicians, nurses, and other healthcare providers gathered, along with some medical students, to share the science, to talk about the science more. And it's amazing. The results that can be obtained by switching from the standard American diet to a plant-based diet. Mm-hmm. It is so clear that the standard American diet is the root cause of many of these chronic diseases. And some people may have a genetic predisposition to certain diseases, but those genes don't have to be turned on. Mm-hmm. And if they've gotten turned on, because of dietary lifestyle, turns out we can turn them back off. Mm-hmm.
That's hope.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
That's hope. That's actually hope.
Yes. And mm-hmm. one of the most amazing things that I heard over the weekend was the reversal of diabetic neuropathy.
Mm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. There was a case where in 12 days, somebody's response to a plant-based diet was so remarkable. Their blood sugars didn't come down tremendously in those 12 days. They did over the next few months, but mm-hmm. in just 12 days, their diabetic neuropathy was gone. They had no more pain.
Yes. Now, I'm going to tell you how beautiful that is. That I watched a video that I thought that you referred, you didn't refer it to me. You mentioned it on the show.
Okay. Yes.
And I don't know that you realize you mentioned it on the show about diabetic neuropathy.
Okay.
And you didn't use that phrase, diabetic neuropathy, but you were talking about a gentleman in New York City.
Yes.
And he had diabetic neuropathy. And I was thinking in my mind that you were talking, oh, that's neuropathy. Mm-hmm. The gentleman friends, it's her time to talk, but I just want to refer you, look for this video. You remember the name?
Eric Adams mm-hmm. and Lysandra actually put it on a Facebook page
yes.
that we're going to tell you guys about
yes.
in a little
okay,
bit.
Okay, mm-hmm. Eric.
Adams.
Eric Adams, friends. Mm-hmm. Gentleman had diabetic neuropathy. If you could put diabetes in stages, by the time you get to state, and the top stage is 4, at the time you start losing feelings in your fingertips and stuff like that, and your eyesight is getting more and more dim and things like that, that's a really tough state.
Right.
And are you talking about reversing that in 12 days?
Correct. Getting rid of it completely.
Getting rid of it completely in 12 days. Friends, if you're struggling with diabetes, you need to listen to this. Mm-hmm. You need to listen to this. I personally know, in fact, let me put it to you like this. My grandmother died in 1978, and I was about 5 or 6 years old. And I remember the last time I saw her, we were in a hospital. She had just gotten her leg amputated. My grandfather, which was her husband, struggled with that. My father died at 52 years old, complications with diabetes. Listen, friends, diabetes is not necessarily a death sentence. It's not even necessarily mean that you have to be a slave to pills anymore.
That's right.
Or to medications. Listen to what she has to say. And listen, friends, refer this show to other people.
Yes.
Because some powerful stuff is about to be said.
And I will tell you, too, I do want to mention that it is powerful. And it's powerful in a way that anyone listening and who's going to try this plant-based diet needs to be consciously taking care of their blood sugar levels, monitoring them, because they can become hypoglycemic. If they leave their medications at their normal dose and they switch to a plant-based diet, in a few weeks, the changes may have occurred such that all of a sudden their blood sugar gets significantly lower than it should be because they're still taking their medications at the same level and they can become hypoglycemic and have, you know,
so
tremors, lightheadedness, they can pass out. Like, these things are very dangerous. Mm-hmm. So if you are on diabetes medications and you go on a plant-based diet, you need to be careful and you need to be monitoring yourself and you need to, you know, notify your doctor that you're going to be doing this and you might need your blood, your medications lowered. Mm-hmm. And blood pressure is the same way. I did want to mention that if you're somebody who suffers from high blood pressure and your blood pressure starts to come down, but you're still taking your medications at the same dose, might drop it too low. Mm-hmm. Right. So you need to be careful.
Okay.
But that is the end goal.
Yes.
Is to get off your medication anyway.
Medication,
right. Yeah. So, well, when we talked about diabetes last time, I'm just going to reiterate that it was discovered that it's the fat that gets into the cells that blocks the ability of insulin to allow sugar to be pulled from the bloodstream.
Into the cell.
Right. So the sugar's high, but the sugar's not causing diabetes. The sugar, high sugar is a symptom of diabetes. Mm-hmm. It's not the cause. the fat has gotten in the cell and it's, you know, like gum in a lock, and it's blocking that insulin receptor from allowing the glucose to get in. Mm-hmm. So that fat, where does that fat come from? It comes from the fat in our diet. So where do we have sources of fat in our diet? Mostly from animal foods, from meat, mm-hmm. from dairy. Mm-hmm. Cheese is 70% fat. Bacon, sausage, these things are, you know, 80-90% fat. They're very, very fatty. You know, a hamburger, at least 50% fat. Even a skinless chicken breast is over 20% fat. Mm-hmm. I think it's at 23%. So that fat in the diet is mm-hmm. what puts fat in the cells, which then leads to these insulin receptors not working anymore. So getting fat out of the diet, animal products, and then added oils. A lot of people use oils sort of without even thinking about it, while they're cooking, while they're sauteing. Mm-hmm. I think the greatest fat content for women is usually salad dressings. So these are things, areas where you can look to pull fat out of your diet by taking those out. Mm. Yeah. So,
wow.
Yeah. So the other thing I was going to just mention is that we talked about, I think I mentioned Caldwell Esselstyn in our last show. He's been a pioneer in cardiovascular disease mm-hmm. and reversing heart disease and, you know, stroke, these sorts of things by using a plant-based diet.
Reversing it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So not only can we reverse diabetes, but heart disease, which is the number one killer of people in the U.S., can be reversed with a plant-based diet. And it's significant because when fat deposits in your blood vessels, it doesn't, it's not selective, you know, it's everywhere. So when somebody has chest pain, and you're like, oh, they have a blockage in their left anterior descending, one of their arteries around their heart. They're like, oh, I'm going to go get a stent placed, right? Well, putting that stent in might fix that one little area for some period of time, but it doesn't mean they don't have vascular disease elsewhere in their body. Right?
We've got that's true.
We've got thousands and thousands of miles of blood
arteries.
Vessels. Mm-hmm. Yes. And so these things can deposit everywhere. And I do like to mention to people that even small vessels are affected very early on because
veins and capillaries.
Right. Well, and small arterial mm-hmm. vessels, the arterioles, mm-hmm. And people, you know, ED mm-hmm. is, you know, a very common disease nowadays, mm-hmm. and that's caused by clogged arteries.
Wow.
And people often say, you know, it's sort of the first sign that you've got vascular disease. So I think that's a very important thing for people to know about. Because it's not that, you know, all of a sudden you're afraid of your wife anymore, right? Like,
oh, yeah. That is very interesting.
Yeah. So, and I think, I think the drug companies tried to make it sound like it's something else, mm-hmm. you know, when really it's just a sign of vascular disease.
Well, mm-hmm. if they don't tell you, well, number one, they may not know. But second of all, if they do know but not telling you, it's because they may want to just sell you something else.
Well, it turns out that the reason that they figured out that it worked for uh-huh. that problem uh-huh. was because they were testing the drug for heart disease.
For heart disease.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Uh-huh. I heard that.
Yeah.
They were trying to figure out, I guess, to dilate the arteries.
Right. So you can increase blood flow. So
you can increase, and then found out it had an interesting side effect.
Right. Exactly.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, we can use it for this then.
Right.
Very interesting.
So anyway, I just wanted to mention vascular disease mm-hmm. and diabetes. Those are two of the most common chronic diseases that we have and ones that we know we can tackle with a plant-based diet. So I think we should dive into the power plate more.
Yes.
We started to talk about it 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
The power plate is fruits, vegetables, legumes, and grains.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the four foods that are central to a plant-based diet. People who try to eat a plant-based diet of, you know, lettuce, cucumbers, and fruit are going to starve. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, when you tell them plant-based diet, they just picture these big salads.
Yeah, big salad, mm-hmm, yes.
With nothing else going on. Yeah. You'd be really hungry if you did that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So grains and legumes are so important. So our grains are rice, wheat, mm-hmm, rye, barley, oats.
Mm-hmm.
And our legumes are going to be our black beans, our kidney beans, mm-hmm, lentils, mm-hmm, which can be red, green, black.
Or quinoa.
Peas. Uh-huh. We've got quinoa. We've got chickpeas. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm, so grains and legumes are going to be critical mm-hmm, to completing the plate for a plant-based meal.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So, so I thought we would go into some myths about mm-hmm, plant-based eating.
Mm-hmm.
And Lysandra had some great questions for me mm-hmm, that are good points for us to touch on.
Mm-hmm.
One is about nutrient deficiencies.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get nutrient deficiencies on a plant-based diet?
Yeah, because mm-hmm, you're not eating everything we
yeah,
eat.
I mean, well, it sounds like an oxymoron, but people generally do assume that you'll be missing something in that type mm-hmm, of plant-based lifestyle.
Right.
That's actually pretty common. I hear mm-hmm, that. I've heard that multiple times.
So enlighten us,
yes,
Brooke.
So actually, I think of it in reverse. If I think about the standard American diet, it's really not very colorful at all. And colors sort of mm-hmm, indicate different vitamins and minerals that are in our foods. That's why when you're in elementary school, they say eat the rainbow,
mm-hmm,
right? So we've got blueberries and watermelon and tomatoes that have lycopene and you know, our greens and our oranges that have beta carotene, our carrots. So that, the eating the rainbow, that's where you get all your vitamins and minerals. You don't get all your vitamins and minerals from a white chicken breast or a chicken nugget or mm-hmm, a French fry. Think how pale and colorless those things are, mm-hmm, right? Potato chips.
Well,
yeah,
well, meat has nice color if it's raw.
If it's raw, it's got a bright
pink color.
Right. So it's got blood in it. So mm-hmm, it's got heme iron in it. And actually, we know now that heme iron is not so good for us.
Mm-hmm.
The iron that we get from plants is non-heme iron.
Mm-hmm.
And that's totally fine. And our body regulates that well.
Mm-hmm.
But heme iron, there seem to be some detrimental effects from heme iron. But so when I think of nutrient deficiencies, only one jumps to mind that plant-based eaters need to be aware of, and that's B12. Now, B12 is also now recommended for anyone. Plant-based eaters, omnivores, whatever you want to call yourself, B12 is recommended for anybody over the age of 50.
Mm-hmm.
B12 is made by bacteria in the soil. So it's absorbed up into the plants, and when the animals eat it, they take in that B12 and those bacteria, and then they pass it on through their meat.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with plant-based eaters is that generally we wash our vegetables. The animals don't wash their vegetables when they eat them. So they're able to take up those bacteria that are making the B12. But we wash our vegetables, and therefore we don't get that bacteria that make the B12, so we need to supplement it. But we only need 2.4 micrograms per day. That is tiny.
Yes.
Tiny. So I just tell people, you just buy a bottle of B12. Usually it's 500 micrograms in one pill.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the least you can buy. 500 micrograms. We only need 2.4 per day.
Mm-hmm.
So I tell people, just cut it in half.
Mm-hmm.
Have one on Wednesday and one on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a half.
Mm-hmm.
So you're having one pill per week. And that bottle is going to last you all year.
Okay, so now here's the big question then. If B12 is essential, well, it would be deficient. If you don't have it, what is it good for? Is it good for brain function or?
It's good for nerves.
Nerves,
yeah.
Okay.
Now, so the first sign of B12 deficiency is sort of a nerve symptoms like tingling, numbness.
Oh, that's if you don't have B12.
Yeah. Okay. Now, a B12 deficiency can also cause a type of anemia. but it's different from iron deficiency anemia. So B12 deficiency anemia is actually more common in plant-based eaters who don't take B12, but iron deficiency anemia is not any different in meat eaters versus plant-based eaters, because plant-based eaters get iron from plants in, you know, perfectly good quantities. So there's really no need to worry about nutrient deficiencies on a plant-based diet. You actually get more nutrients usually, because people eat a broader range of fruits and vegetables
and legumes
and legumes and grains.
Wow, don't worry about nutrient deficiencies.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So one of the main nutrients that people ask about is calcium. Because how many ads did we see growing up of people with the milk mustache?
Sure. Yes, exactly.
Yes.
And milk does your body good.
Milk and does. Yeah, that's what I was getting ready to say.
The milk mustache.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so my first question is, why are we concerned about calcium? And the answer is bone health, right? Like, that's the main thing we worry about calcium for. We worry about osteoporosis. Okay, so where does calcium come from? Do cows make calcium?
No, something that they eat gives it to them.
Right, it's a mineral that's in the earth. So when they eat, it's taken up into the plants, and when they eat the plants, they absorb the calcium. Well, it turns out nowadays, 99% of cows are in, you know, confined operations.
Sure.
And so they're just given grain. Well, you can go online and search for bovine, which means cow, bovine calcium, so that you can add it to your cow's feed if you're the farmer. So it's just a bottle of pills, just like we would get in the pharmacy if we wanted to take calcium. So the cows are now taking calcium supplements so that there's calcium in their milk, because they're not even grazing.
Right, exactly. In a pasture like they normally would under normal circumstances.
So we can just cut out the middleman, and if we eat our greens, then we get our calcium.
So when you say greens, you mean spinach, kale, collards, and whatever. Would you say greens?
Any lettuces. Arugula, romaine.
And so, that gives us the calcium that the meat eaters think that, that we wouldn't have.
Yes. So greens and beans. I just tell people those rhyme and it's easy to remember. Beans also have a lot of calcium.
There you go.
Greens and beans.
Greens and beans.
And so I think another interesting question is, how much calcium do we really need? Because in the U.S., the recommended amount of calcium per day is 100 or 1,000 to 1,300 milligrams, based depending on your age and gender. Do you know what the recommendation is in the UK and Europe?
Lower.
700 milligrams per day.
Per day, okay.
And do you know how much calcium they get in Asia and India?
No.
400 to 700 milligrams per day.
Oh, even lower.
Yeah. And do you know who has the highest rates of osteoporosis?
Americans?
Yes. People who consume the most dairy have the highest rates of osteoporosis. Yeah. So
that is crazy.
Yeah. So
well, that's ironic then.
Yes.
That's ironic. That's exactly the opposite of what you would think would expect. What you would expect. So
why
the
is that
disconnect?
Going on?
Why the ironic disconnect?
Well, it turns out that animal products create an acidic environment in the body. And when that happens, in order to buffer that acidic environment, we leach calcium from our bones to neutralize it. And that calcium gets leached into our bloodstream just to neutralize, and then it goes to get excreted in our kidneys, and also increases the rates of kidney stones. Because kidney stones are made up of calcium oxalate in most cases. Yes. So we're taking in all this calcium, but we're creating this acidic environment. We're trying to neutralize it. So we are taking it from our own bones.
Yeah, to neutralize the acidity.
Right. And then we're
trying
to
pass
it
out, and then try to pass it out the body.
It's crazy, right? Yeah, so greens and beans. That's where we want to get our calcium.
Wow, that is funny.
Okay.
That is funny.
Yeah.
Isn't that funny?
It is.
Okay. So, the other...
Go ahead. Here's what I want you to do.
Okay.
I want you to talk about this last thing that you're getting ready to talk about.
Okay.
I don't know what it is. Talk about that. then take a break.
Okay.
After we take the break, I still want you to talk about these misconceptions, these concerns. Very important. But I want to give the listeners plenty of time to talk, to hear about the 21-day kickstart.
Okay, definitely. That's very important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we have about 25 minutes left, I would assume. Okay. So we're going to, I want you to finish this last point.
Okay.
We're going to take a break. We're going to deal, friends, more misconceptions and concerns. And then they're going to give you a major, major treat. Major treat. 21-day kickstart. Right after she finishes this point, we're going to take a break. It only gets better, friends. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, I wanted to make one more point about dairy because a lot of milk says no hormones added.
Yes.
So people assume that the milk doesn't have hormones in it. Well, the milk comes from a lactating mammal. And if you've ever had children, you know you have hormones while you're lactating, right?
Yes, that's true.
Okay.
Indeed. So, amen.
So milk has hormones in it.
I know,
it has
that's
a lot of estradiol in it, okay? Regardless of whether or not any has been added. So organic or not, milk has a lot of hormones in it. And therefore, any cancers that are hormonally driven, this would be breast cancer, uterine cancer, ovarian cancer, testicular cancer, and prostate cancer.
Oh my goodness.
The risk of these cancers increases when you consume dairy.
More dairy.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I just want to point that out because I think people don't think about the hormones that are in the milk.
Wow.
And they're there.
Powerful point.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Bussard. Incredible, incredible. Never fear, friends. We'll be right back after this break.
I've got a reason. NPR listeners. My name is Sonia Williams, and I am a financial empowerment coach with World Financial Group. We are on a mission to financially educate 1 million families by 2020. We will teach you how money works, how to manage your own money, and how to make your money work for you. And all of the services we provide are 100% free. So please give me a call. My phone number is 571-316-5877. Again, this is Sonia Williams, and my phone number is 571-316-5877.
Do you or someone you may know have a child with disabilities? Are you overwhelmed by the special education process? Do you need help? My name is Eva Queen, founder and executive director of Community Advocates for You, Incorporated. Community Advocates is a nonprofit whose mission and values are rooted in compassion, integrity, and a desire to support the disabled within the African American community. We are a network of professionals, parents, and community partners who have joined forces to provide person-centered support to children with disabilities and their families. All of our services are free. Community Advocates for You provides parent trainings, community case management, personalized IEP review and support, and DDA support brokerage. For more information, email us at help@advocatesforyou.org. I'm going to spell that out for you. It's advocates, A-D-V-O-C-A-T-E-S, the number 4, Y-O-U.org. Or you can visit us on our website at www.advocatesforyou.org. You can reach us by phone at 443-219-2883. And you can also follow us on Facebook and Twitter.
Good afternoon, friends. Welcome back to the Just Word Show. I know you've just been waiting on the edge of your seat to get some more of this meaty, or maybe I should say veggie information, because it's just mind-boggling. It's incredible. It's mind-boggling. It's a blessing to hear it. And it only gets better, friends. Dr. Bussard has so graciously decided to come and share with us out of her busy time, her schedule. And, you know, actually, if you were to come to her office for a consultation, she could charge you good money for this. So just be thankful. And guess what else? Share it with folks that you know could benefit from this information. Yes. You need to share it. Mm-hmm. Now, check this out. You can go directly to our YouTube channel, The Just Word Show on YouTube, and you can check out Dr. Brooke Bussard. Check it out. You need to share it. You need to avail yourself of the information that's there. And look, email it to folks, text it to folks, mm-hmm. and let folks know, hey, look, there's something here that's going to help you. Something here that's going to bless you. And guess what? It gets even better, because they're going to talk about more concerns and more misconceptions Dr. Bussard is about to talk about. And then they're going to talk about the 21-day kickstart. Mm-hmm. It's just amazing. I'm thankful that I'm a part of this. Yes. I'm serious. I'm thankful that I'm a part of this. Okay? So without any further delay, I'm going to get out of your way, and then I'm going to let it. I'm going to let her continue to carry us on with her expertise.
All right. Thanks, Julius. All right. So Lysandra sent another good question to me, which was, do people on a plant-based diet lack protein? Because people often think that they need meat to get their protein. Mm-hmm. So first, I'd like everybody to consider the 10 largest land animals on the planet.
Rhinoceros, elephant.
Give me one more.
Hippopotamus.
There you go. Okay.
They're gigantic.
Yeah.
That sounds like gorillas.
Anybody idea?
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Gorillas, too.
Anybody know what they eat?
The herbivores.
Well,
they are.
Oh, well, no need to guess anymore. They're plant eaters. You already answered it.
They're plant eaters. Yep. Mm-hmm. And they get all the protein that they need. Mm-hmm. So when people are wondering, where do I get my protein? The first questions I like them to think about is, well, how much protein do I really need? Because I think we're in a society where everybody wants more of everything all the time, regardless of whether it's food or anything else. More, more, more. Mm-hmm. Turns out you only need a certain amount, and more than that is going to be detrimental. for many different reasons, but the most obvious reason is that if you take in too many calories from any source of food, it's going to be stored as fat. Mm-hmm. Because when we don't use it, it's got to go somewhere. Mm-hmm. Right.
It's going to be stored around your waist.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Or your thighs or your belly. Uh-huh. Yeah, all sorts mm-hmm. of good places. Okay, so we need protein. We need it to build and repair muscle. Mm-hmm. We need it to make enzymes, to make hormones, to make antibodies, to fight infections. Mm-hmm. But it is not the primary source of energy for the human body. The human body runs on glucose. And we store glucose as glycogen in our muscle and in our liver. And those are our primary sources of fuel for our daily activities. The protein is used, like I said, to make hormones and enzymes and build mm-hmm. tissue.
Repair muscles.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But it's not as if you keep taking in more protein, it just goes and slaps onto the bicep. Oh, it's going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work that way. Mm-hmm. Like when you build muscle, that's because you've created a stimulus from lifting weights or doing some sort of exercise. The muscle tears itself and mm-hmm. it needs to rebuild, and you're going to replenish that with some protein, but you only need so much, and your body can actually only absorb so much protein at one time. Mm-hmm. Then it needs to break down that protein into amino acids to be used in the body or to be excreted. And when it breaks down amino acids, we get a nitrogenous waste, because nitrogen is found in protein, but it's not found in carbohydrates. Mm-hmm. And when nitrogen builds up in the body, it's very dangerous for people who have kidney disease, people who are on dialysis. Mm-hmm. When nitrogen builds up in the body, it's either, if it can't be excreted through the urine, it can be deposited in joint spaces. And that's how you get gout.
Oh, my goodness.
Okay? So that's why people who eat a lot of red meat often have an issue with gout. Mm-hmm. So we need to remember that we only need so much protein. Mm-hmm. The biggest land animals, the herbivores, they get all they need mm-hmm. from their plant-based diet, and mm-hmm. so can we.
And they're the strongest, too.
And they're the strongest. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So the other thing about too much protein is that it's linked to certain kinds of cancer. Colorectal cancer, bladder, and prostate cancers are all linked to too much animal protein. And I think I touched on that 2 weeks ago, that the World Health Organization in, when was that, 2015, They finally put processed meats as a level one carcinogen.
Carcinogen. Yes. Mm-hmm. Wow.
So bacon, sausage, hot dogs, yes. Any of those processed meats. And then it has red meat as a level 2A carcinogen. So a probable carcinogen. It hasn't bumped it up to a level one yet. But they have, you know, it takes hundreds and hundreds of studies. It took over 600 studies mm-hmm. to get processed meat yeah. in that level one. Yeah. It took over 800 studies to get tobacco in that level mm-hmm. one when finally they decided that cigarettes could kill you. Mm-hmm. yeah. So it's just an amount of studies yeah. before they.
And I was going to ask you to kind of put that in perspective mm-hmm. for us. Mm-hmm. Isn't that on the same level as smoking and asbestos?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Uh-huh. Pretty serious.
It's very serious. The amount of young people mm-hmm. who are getting colon and rectal cancer, if you were born in 1990 versus someone who was born in 1950, you have twice the risk of colon cancer mm-hmm. and four times the risk of rectal cancer.
Because of the way the food is prepared and processed and things.
Exactly. Because people born in 1990 eat so much more processed food than people born in 1950.
1950, right, yeah. Exactly.
Wow. So, and that's devastating because yeah, when you see colon and rectal cancer in 40-something year olds, it started when they were in their teenage years eating this processed meat. And every time that processed meat is dragging along those cells that line your GI tract and irritating them, and they're like, oh God, what is that? and the cell's in there and it's mutating and it's like, oh, we got to change something in here. And it's, you know, coming in contact with these substances that it doesn't like at all. And the DNA changes and eventually mutates enough that you then get cancer.
Yes, that's true. I understood that you could literally have cancer for 14 years in your body before you start to see symptoms enough to take you to a doctor. You can have cells in your body mutating, and then, you know, years and years later, it's going to reproduce again the same bad DNA after it mutated the first time.
Right, right.
And then, of course, you have groups, thousands and thousands and thousands of cells all doing that. And you have no clue that that's happening in your body until you start to see the symptoms enough to make you want to go to the doctor.
Right.
And then they discover it.
Right.
Well, that's been years and years it's been working that.
Yeah,
that
some process. Cancers are very slow growing. Mm-hmm. And so you don't notice.
It's incredible.
For a while, yeah.
Yeah, well, I knew you didn't know him, but I you knew him, Scott Throp. I knew a guy who, when they discovered he had bladder cancer, and they said that they believed that that cancer was growing inside of his body for about 6 years.
Oh, wow.
Before they finally discovered it. Well, it turns out they had diagnosed him with having level 3. Well, after weeks and weeks that went by, they're doing treatments and, you know, they're exams and things like that, they said, wait a minute, this is far worse than we thought it was. And it was level 4 and it was already metastasized to different parts of his body. It was even in his brain.
Yeah.
And when they had discovered it in his brain just a few months later after he got the first diagnosis, they discovered it in his brain, it was already the size of a golf ball. And needless to say, he only lived a few months later.
Right.
No, I'm sorry, he lived 18 months after the first diagnosis, about 18 months.
Yeah, and that's devastating.
Even with the, obviously, the radiation and the chemotherapy and all that kind of stuff, they thought it was level 3, but then turned, oh, no, I'm sorry. No, this is way worse than we thought it was.
Right.
And he thought, out of his own mouth, he thought he was healthy as a horse. That's what he said.
Yeah, yeah.
And had this cancer growing inside of his body.
Right.
I noticed also on your list, you said bladder cancer, that they have traced it back to literally meat protein.
Right. So that's one.
One kind.
Kind. Yeah. Yeah, one cause.
One,
yeah.
Or one potential cause.
Yeah.
Of,
yeah.
Of what it could come from.
Right. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So we got to be careful, friends, of what we feed in our bodies, mm-hmm. because a lot of the things that we put in our bodies, it may not hurt the minute you put it in, mm-hmm. but it can, and it may be tasty the minute you put it in.
Right.
But, you know, years and years of abuse and your cells and your body just constantly trying to fight this. You can imagine if I just took a pen and cut my skin open and I don't let it heal. And I cut it open again. Mm-hmm. A lot of times that's what we do with our meals.
That's a very good analogy. That's a very good analogy.
Your body's trying to heal itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you throw down another ham sandwich.
Right. And it is no chance of healing. Mm-hmm.
Yes. And then after a year of doing that, you might as well just amputate the arm.
Right.
Because now it's all gangrene. It's got ink all in it and everything.
Well, Julie, that takes me to the next question that Lissandra asked. This is actually a perfect segue because she asked, what about children? Can children eat this way?
Okay.
And I wanted to read to you from the American Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics. They put out a position statement in 2016 and said that an appropriately planned plant-based diet is healthful, nutritionally adequate, and may provide health benefits for the prevention and treatment of certain diseases. These diets are appropriate for all stages of the life cycle, including pregnancy, lactation, infancy, childhood, adolescence, older adulthood, and for athletes, which I know you asked about also. Plant-based diets are more environmentally sustainable than diets rich in animal products because they use fewer natural resources and are associated with much less environmental damage. Vegans are at reduced risk of certain health conditions, including ischemic heart disease, type 2 diabetes, hypertension, certain types of cancer, and obesity. Low intake of saturated fat and high intakes of vegetables, fruits, whole grains, legumes, soy products, nuts, and seeds, all rich in fiber and phytochemicals, are characteristics of these diets that produce lower total and low density lipoprotein cholesterol levels and better serum glucose control. So that is the position statement from the dietetics and nutrition community.
That's any stage in the life cycle.
Right, right.
Wow.
So, and thinking about athletes, because a lot of people think, well, there's no way I can do this, I'm an athlete. And my first answer is, if I say Venus Williams, do I have to say anything else?
No, she's a world-class athlete.
Right.
Plain and simple.
And she's plant-based.
Really?
And she's plant-based because she got an autoimmune disease called Sjogren's syndrome. Causes dry eyes, dry mouth, then it can lead to other symptoms, joint pain. And she got her diagnosis of Sjogren's syndrome. She, you know, fell out of, you know, the match that she was in at the time and took maybe even up to 2 years off, I think, trying to figure this out. And Serena ended up going plant-based with her to support her. The two of them have stayed on a plant-based diet and, you know, came back perfectly strong and, you know, an amazing athlete.
Well, they've both been at literally at the top of the game.
Yeah.
For 15 years.
Yeah. And the, and I cannot think of his name.
Carl
Lewis, definitely.
Yeah, and he was at the top of his game for 20 years.
Yeah.
Well into his 40s.
Yeah. And the guy who just won one of the big tennis matches in the past month or two. Can't think of his name, but he's plant-based also. And then I jotted down, did I jot down some others? Do you know David Carter? He was a defensive lineman. They call him the 300-pound vegan.
Wow.
He's done a lot of PR for PCRM and Forks Over Knives.
That's
funny.
You're not going to believe this because I was thinking, okay, I can understand a tennis player, they're lean-looking people. I could, you know, they're the nature of what they do.
Runners,
It just kind of looks like, okay, they look like they could be plant-based folks. But no, not football players. Not football players. Or maybe even boxers, too, because they're thick dudes.
Oh, Mike Tyson's vegan.
Oh, he is?
Except for the ear he
Even
ate.
Even when he was thumping people, he was plant-based?
Yes, he was.
I mean, when he was thumping people.
That's what I'm told.
Wow, that's incredible.
Yeah.
That's absolutely... Besides, I guess he had a... he backslid just for that one
Yeah,
day.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, that's funny. I saw that fight too. That was
did you?
Yeah, I saw it when he bit him.
Yeah. So speaking of that,
that's funny.
We've got a great graphic to sort of describe. So when I think of David Carter, I think, holy cow, this guy must eat a tremendous amount of food each day.
That's a lot of grapes.
We have a graphic that shows you what 500 calories looks like in the stomach. And when you look at it, you'll notice that 500 calories of oil takes up 1/5 or 1/6 of the stomach. Cheese, just a little bit more than that. Meat doesn't even come up halfway. But then you've got potatoes, rice, and beans. 500 calories of those almost fills the stomach.
Yep,
and 500 calories of fruits and vegetables, totally full. So when people ask, will I feel satisfied
on
a plant-based diet?
Good question.
The answer is yes, and you'll be satisfied with fewer calories because those stretch receptors in your stomach that send the signal to the brain that you're full, that you feel satiated, those signals are able to be put out with fewer calories when you're eating a plant-based diet.
Because those calories aren't as concentrated in such a small volume.
Yes. They're not concentrated.
Whereas you could eat, you know, 500 calories in grapes or tomatoes or bananas, mm-hmm. and it be this much.
Right. Yeah, because we've got water.
Yes.
We've got fiber. Uh-huh. And yeah, we're just not condensed with those calories, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, you know, I think people are worried about cooking and mm-hmm. how much time it takes mm-hmm. sure. To learn how to do this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And here's where I think we all just need to take a step back and ask ourselves, well, why are we doing it? Mm-hmm. And is it worth it?
Mm-hmm.
Because anytime we make a change, we have obstacles to overcome.
Mm-hmm.
But usually things get easier the more you do them.
Mm-hmm.
So even if it feels daunting at first, always remember, things get easier with time and practice.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'd like to talk now about a 21-day kickstart that mm-hmm. Lissandra and I are putting together mm-hmm. on the Facebook page, created a Facebook page specifically mm-hmm. for this. And we want to help you be successful. We want to help you learn how to cook this way if you need to. We want to supply recipes. We want to provide support.
Yes.
We talked a little bit about the Blue Zones 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that the people in the Blue Zones are the longest lived healthiest people on the planet is not only because they eat a plant-based diet, but because they have support and community. And so having this group is the support and the community that we can provide. And I think it's very valuable. It's an important part.
Mm-hmm.
So I want you guys to use it. I want you to ask questions. I want you to share struggles. Every day, mm-hmm. I will put up a quiz.
Okay.
Every day, wow.
Uh-huh. Every day for 21 days, I'll put up a quiz. That's just one question.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that everybody learns something every day.
Yes.
And if you already knew it, mm-hmm. go tell somebody about it mm-hmm. who doesn't know it.
Mm-hmm.
Share it.
Mm-hmm.
So Lissandra, what else do you want to say about that?
I just want to say, you know, it's really for wherever you are in this transition, whether you are, like you said, any part of the life cycle, whether you are a teenager, whether you are someone that's maybe more mature, whether you are an athlete, you know, whether you have a family or you're single, you know, or perhaps you want to test drive this, you know, 21-day plant-based lifestyle before fully committing, you know, this group is here for you. We've already created some content for you. We're in the community already waiting for you to come and join and be a part of what we're doing. This is life-changing. It's life-saving. You've heard the information today and 2 weeks ago. It's compelling. It's empowering. You know, it's an opportunity for us to be able to take control of our own lives and our own health. And do something different to get a different outcome. And so I personally am very excited about this opportunity and coming together to make a positive impact in this Facebook, in this cyber world. You know, in the time we live in, the technology is so advanced and there's a proliferation of information. Sometimes it's like drinking from a water fountain. You know, and so this is a place where you can get the concentration and support for a plant-based lifestyle. That's all we're going to promote. That's all you're going to see. Information that's going to educate you, that's going to encourage you, that's going to help you, thought-provoking to help you learn information. And if you're struggling, a place where you can feel comfortable to share about that and get some real help and some real encouragement along the way. And so I understand already we have some young people in the group already who are teenagers. And so we're looking forward to providing you the tools and resources and support you need as well to continue in this journey and be successful at being plant-based as a lifestyle, not just as a diet, but as a lifestyle. So we are here. We kick off on August the 20th. So in 8 days, we officially kick off on August the 20th. So in your Facebook browser, you can type in the just word 21-day plant-based challenge kickoff, and you will be able to find us and you can join the group. We'd love to have you. We've already had some information being shared and some exchanges happening in the community. So we want you to be a part of this life-changing experience as well. It's 21 days. It's 21 days. Join us for 21 days, and then we'll see what happens next after that. But We're going to have a great time and learn and be empowered and change our lives in 21 days and change our habits, our thoughts, mm-hmm. our desires, our taste buds. And so I'm looking forward to what's going to be happening in the next 21 days.
And I think I'll just say one more thing about the page. Mm-hmm. Sharing pictures of what you're eating mm-hmm. will be so helpful.
Yes.
Because I feel like food is like clothing. Everybody wears everything a little bit differently, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And people have very different, you know, just a wide spectrum of tastes. Mm-hmm. And so for one person who might like overnight oats, another person's like, oh, that's not in my wheelhouse. I've got to go for something, you know, heartier. That's, you know, not that that's not hearty, but somebody might think a stack of pancakes would be a better choice for them.
Whole grain, that is.
Whole grain pancakes, right. So just keep that in mind, that mm-hmm. if you see a recipe and you don't like it, it doesn't mean you don't like plant-based eating.
Sure.
Right? The same thing could be said for omnivores, you know, mm-hmm. for the meat-eating community. There's certain things people like and don't like. So mm-hmm. just find what you like mm-hmm. and stick with it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And just to reiterate, and you said it earlier, you said it 2 weeks ago, that we are focusing on eating from the power plate.
Right.
You know, using some of those basic recipes and things that you're already currently eating and just kind of transitioning them to be plant-based. And so it doesn't have to be difficult. It doesn't have to be something that you have to purchase special ingredients for or worry about things being inaccessible to you. Farmers markets are great places to shop. You can shop in your produce section of your store, even save some dollars. So the money you would have spent toward all of your dairy and eggs and meat, you can kind of shift that toward purchasing your produce, whether it be frozen or fresh. And so we just look forward to being able to be a part of what is happening in this community and be a part of the life-changing experience that you will experience during these 21 days.
Wow, friends, what a show. What a show. What a show. It's just absolutely incredible. Thank you, Dr. Brooke, for coming again. Thank you for helping us even with the 21-day challenge.
Yes.
Kickstart. Yes. I keep putting challenge in there. It is going to be a challenge.
Well, I know. I was sort of contemplating challenge because some people really love that word, you know?
Yeah. You know, so I just keep putting challenge in there. Yeah. But it is going to be a challenge for some folks.
Sure.
But hey, regardless of how much the challenge is, we're going to push through this thing together, and
yes.
all of us are going to get better through this together on this new community that they're creating. But here is the point that I want to share. I heard this. I don't know that I can take credit for this. I heard this from a friend of mine, David Brown. And he said, look, the reason why us as believers, listen, I said believers, it's the Just Word Show. We're on Awesome God Radio. I just would assume, and it's probably a safe assumption, 85% of the folks that listen to us are believers. And if you're not a believer, great. Keep listening. That's awesome.
Yeah.
But I want to say to my friends, my pastors, my elders, my yes. deacons, my missionaries,
yes.
whether you're a songwriter or a musician, like I have so many friends that are songwriters and musicians, singers, whatever you do for God's kingdom, you don't want to move up into your 40s and now you're having aches and pains. And now you can't do it as often with as much energy or quite as efficient and effective as you did in your 20s. What we want to do, whatever good work you're doing, we want to extend out your phase of effectiveness. We want to go past the 20s. We're going to 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. 70s. We want you to do what you do as long as you can do it. If you pastor, if you preach, we don't want health problems to be the reason why you retire.
Mm-hmm.
We want you, if you're a missionary, whatever you do, do it as long as you possibly can. And if your back is hurting,
yeah.
and if your knees are hurting, and if you're dealing with heart problems, you're dealing with health problems. That's much more time that you have to put into something else.
Yeah.
and many more reasons why you can make excuses as to why you can't or you shouldn't. Mm-hmm. Because my back hurt or my knees hurt. Or, hold it, wait a minute. In the middle of a sermon, I got to stop and take my medicine. I know that doesn't happen, but you know. But here, friends, if there is a way that we can curtail and even avoid and sometimes even reverse chronic illnesses, then why not give it a try for a year?
You know, it's
why not give it a try? I'm going to let you close it out.
Yeah, I just wanted to share this really briefly since we're talking about the church community. I read a statistic about 2 weeks ago that the average church that's about 200 members, so if your church may be larger or smaller or much larger or much smaller, the average church that has 200 members, there's about 9 people in that congregation suffering from either diabetes, cancer, or heart disease. And it could be more, undiagnosed or undisclosed, but that there, what I'm saying that to say is that there's a problem, and sometimes we go to the altar, we ask the Lord to help us, but some things He's empowered us to do, and so we need to make the efforts to make the change, to see the true manifestation of healing happen, and not continue along the same path and continue along the same path to continue to go and ask the Lord to heal when He's provided the information and the empowerment for us to walk in that victory fully and completely. So I just wanted to share that. I thought it was an interesting statistic that we as the people of God need to stand up and walk in victory, not just, you know, in our prayer lives, but in what we eat and what we drink. When we shop in the grocery stores, and I know that these things aren't often talked about in the pulpit and in, you know, in our life group ministries, but they're life-changing, they're life-giving, and so why not? So why not? If we're sharing the truth, let's share the truth. Let's be a part of what's happening and be life-promoting, life-saving, all the way across the board. And so I just thank you for the opportunity today, and I have been totally blessed. Brooke, you are a godsend to us, a gold mine, a treasure. We thank you for coming back to the Just Word Show. And please remember that the 21-day plant-based cat challenge will start on August 20th. Please join us. We'll be back next week on Thursday to talk some more about what's happening in and around the community in the plant-based, as well as what's happening in and around the faith-based community. So we thank you for joining us today. As always, share it, catch up with us on YouTube, and we look forward to staying connected with you. We love you. Bye.
All right, here we go. We're getting ready to close out. It's the worst part of the show. The worst part of the show, the time when we have to shut it down. But guess what, friends? If you are a word reader and you believe in Genesis chapter 3, particularly if you believe in Genesis chapters 1 through 10, and you love the word, listen here, and you've read the word, you understand then, all you have to do is read it. It's very simple. That if you believe God created humankind, like I do, then you understand that for the first 1,500 years that humans were on the planet, they all, by God, were told to eat a plant-based diet. And those folks, for the first 1,500 years of human existence, as far as we know it, those people lived hundreds of years on a plant-based diet. Of course, in a world, in a set of conditions that's not like the conditions that we have now. So if God Himself says, eat fruit, eat things that grow in fields, that's the stuff I put here for you to eat, then I think it's something we need to give serious consideration to. So we're getting ready to close out the Just Word Show. Since I know you love the show as much as you love it, that's the reason right there why you need to tune in next week. And it's also the reason why you need to share it. Facebook it, YouTube it, text message, email, whatever you do. Let folks know that there's a blessing right here on Awesome God Radio. Amen. Until next week, we'll see you later.
It's Sierra Arnold, realtor and contractor with Arnold Construction Group, providing all of your real estate and construction needs under one roof. Give us a call at 443-429-2144. 1-800-549-4949 to schedule a consultation today. And you're listening to Awesome God Radio.
Are you looking for the hottest styles of the season? If so, shop Kira's Couture Boutique.
Visit our online store today at www.kiraskoutureboutique.com or shop exclusively where you'll find our products inside of Deity Hair Studio, located 1620 York Road, Suite 108, Lutherville, Maryland 21093.
Choose Kira's Couture Boutique, where our styles are designed with you in mind.
Subscribe to our website for exclusive deals and updates. www.kiraskoutureboutique.com.